Hello, welcome to AK Soufflé. And as you can see, I'm in my natural habitat, a bar. And a very, very nice bar that belongs to a pub owned by a very good friend of mine who I've known now for many years, Tony Leonard. Hello, Tony.
Hello, Andrew.
Let's go into the studio and we'll there we are.
We're in as my, if by magic.
We're in my real home now, which isn't, of course, my real home. It's very nice to have you here. I think we met through a very common factor in our lives, not the fact that we're both gay men, but the fact that we're both passionate about food.
I think we did, yeah.
And back in that day, in those days, you were editing a magazine called Eat Sussex, which was a very good product, but sadly, because of the demise of the print industry, it was unsustainable financially, I believe.
Yeah, we went to... Well, it was the credit crunch. Mm-hmm. It was building until the credit crunch. And we were specialising in small businesses. You know, it wasn't about supermarkets and stuff. It was about small independent producers. And, of course, none of them had the marketing budgets, all went out the window. So, yes.
But you stayed in the food industry because you and your partner, Dominic, actually took over a pub in Lewes, which is...
That's right. Although we had a couple of pubs in Brighton at that point
as well.
Did,
yes. But it was that was something of a turning point, really. The Snowdrop, a very famous and very historic pub in Lewes, and with a very strong local community, which incredibly you hung on to, didn't you?
Yes. Although when we took it on, the place was practically derelict. So it had failed for...
Falling down.
Yeah, the kitchen had been closed by environmental health. The cellar should have been. It had been eight years of demise. Previously, it had been under the maize. It was very famous for food, vegetarian food and live music. Mm-hmm. And Punch Taverns bought it and kind of ran it into the ground with rents that were way too high and stuff. And then Punch got into trouble for a while, so there was a brief window of opportunity where they were selling off lots of pubs.
You were able to?
We got in there then, yeah.
Were you accepted by the Lewes community?
Yes. It was strange because it had become a place that was... Well, for a while, it was kind of a centre of antisocial behaviour. You know, they had drum and bass nights on Sundays.
Good Lord.
And people were going down, leaving there and peeing in letterboxes and stuff. You know, it wasn't a locals' pub. At that point, and the point we took over, nobody was going in, you know, even the drug dealers and everything had left, but there was a period where it was kind of known for drugs. And so my expectation was it would take a long while to win over the locals and to win their trust. Whereas what actually happened was people had very, very fond memories of how it used to be and they really wanted it back. And it was, we were welcomed extremely warmly.
It's amazing, isn't it? You weren't then the only gays in the village.
No, Lewes is an amazing place. It prides itself on its independent spirit.
And its diversity.
And its diversity. And, the idea of... Yeah, Lewes would be deeply offended at the idea of being homophobic in any shape or form.
Really. You weren't ever going to be... cartooned and carried through the Bonfire Night Parade.
We did get blown up by our local Bonfire Society.
You did?
Yeah, but it was for our wedding, and it was a tribute where they made an exploding cake with effigies of us on the top. So it was the most moving part of our wedding. I was kind of
That's wonderful.
And got to and the effigies actually survived and they're in a glass case in the pub now.
They survived the explosion.
They did, yeah, because it was packed with
like all good homosexuals do. We are strong in adversity.
We are indeed.
You went on in the last few years to take over another pub that wasn't doing brilliantly. The demise of a lot of our beautiful country pubs is that because people don't drink and drive, unless you're offering great food, you can't really survive, and especially in a small village. And the Roebuck is in Lawton, which is not a very large village.
No, it's a very, no, very small village, I think. Yeah, and that was closed for 2 years. So, that's been an interesting...
Well, it's been more than interesting. You're being very modest about this, because the Roebuck went on to win a national competition, and you are... are still the best pub in...
We're currently the best free house in the UK. I just had to write something, actually, because they're writing up stuff for the awards this year. Mm-hmm. So, but we're 2017's free house of the year. And we were finalists as food pub and inn as well. And the Snowdrop a few years previously was finalist. Southeast winner, similarly shortlisted as food pub, free house and beer pub.
Well, as you know, I'm very fond of coming to the Snowdrop because it's on the way to my favourite venue in Sussex, which is Glyndebourne, and it's a great place to stop and have lunch before you go over there for several hours of beautiful music. And the food element there has always been traditional with a modern twist, but actually what I love about it is it's a proper plate of food. I mean, you get your dinner. You're not getting, you know, something moopsy in the middle of a plate with a drizzle of something around the outside. You look at it and you think, did the chef look how big I am? I mean, do you honestly think that's going to satisfy my appetite?
Yeah.
And that's been very important, I think, to the way you've tackled the food scene.
It's about, it's about real food. It's about food sourcing. It's you know, we use small local suppliers, and that's really important to us. I've been to all the farms that we get our meat from, our milk and everything else. I know how those animals are treated, and I'm very, very
that's important
happy
to you.
With that. That's really important.
In the same way that actually stocking really great ales is really important to you.
Yes, and we're spoilt in Sussex for brilliant brewers.
So well, you have one of the most brilliant brewers on your doorstep.
We have Harvey's. We have Burning Sky in Firl. There's Gun Brewery.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we are really... Yeah, it's a bit of a golden age, although there is a... I think there are problems in the industry at the moment where it's kind of expanded too big and there's takeovers.
The craft ale scene has grown so rapidly that really it's almost swamped itself, hasn't it?
Yes.
And it must be very difficult for you to decide what to stock and what not to stock.
Yeah. One of the things that we've done at the Snowdrop, we have a beer festival every year, and that's always kind of... after the first one was international, but the second one was Beer Britannica, so it was based around beers from all over the country, and we sort of use that. We work with Mark from Burning Sky to curate that, and that sort
it's
of
more focused.
Yeah, and that they tend to be the breweries that we then go on to use. So there are we specialise in local breweries, but then there are other breweries. Tiny Rebel in Newport in Wales, who are brilliant, and I've never had a you know, they have a huge range of completely different beers, and I've never had a bad one.
Out at Lawton, you have rooms as well.
We do, yes.
And does that mean that you get people who will come for dinner and stay?
Yes.
I must do this, mustn't I?
Yes, you must.
And I'm getting my bicycle out of the shed. Cycle over. As you know, I don't drive anymore. Not because I've been banned, but because I don't own a car anymore. For lots of reasons, I don't want to. The people that come and stay, what sort of people do you attract?
We get quite a wide range. We get Glyndebourne is a big part of our trade. And
of course, I mean, for a lot of people coming down to Glyndebourne, they actually come down the night before and stay the night after, having seen the opera.
And we're one of the closest B&Bs.
Do you do hampers for those guests?
We do.
Really?
Indeed, yes.
Ah, lovely.
That are full of homemade local produce. So.
I'm a terrible snob when I go to Glyndebourne, and I do go to everything there. Mm. And I wander around the garden and assess the quality of people's picnics. And I have to say that there's some very disappointing dress sense these days at Glyndebourne. It's not the glamorous thing that it used to be, particularly for ladies. And I know it's easier for men to put on black tie. But also, you walk past the picnics and I'm going, supermarket dips, no. Really very disappointing. I can't wait to come out to the pub, but I know, busy as your life is, running two very successful pubs, you've discovered another thread in your life in the last few years, and when we come back after the break, I want to talk about that, because I saw you actually performing, because I think reading is performing, and you have to be able to do that. I saw you performing very recently at a Polari meeting here in Brighton at the library, which was such good fun and excellent, wonderful afternoon, wonderful way to spend a Sunday afternoon listening to people reading from their new works. We'll talk about that when we come back. We're going to go to an ad break now and see a few ads. I hope they're not for beer, because it's going to make me thirsty. But we'll come back to you very soon. Hello and welcome back to AK Soufflé. And for once, we've been talking about food, my true passion in life. But I've got Tony Leonard here, and as well as being a successful award-winning publican, landlord, what do you call yourselves these days?
Yeah, landlords is...
Landlords is nice, isn't it? Yes. You've actually embarked on a new thread to your career. It's coming, I know, from the fact that you did write for Eat Sussex, but you're now writing fiction, and you're being very, very successful and acclaimed for this. I know that your novel is now quite well advanced.
It's coming along.
Yeah. Coming along.
I was previously a journalist for many years before I came to Brighton. And I worked for most of the gay press. Mm-hmm. Fiction's something new.
It is a different discipline, isn't it?
It is, yes.
I came along to Polari, which the wonderful Paul Purston was hosting a special Polari here in Brighton with a day before of masterclasses, which local writers, new writers, went along and did the masterclass. And then some of you were selected to actually read from your new projects or from the piece that you'd written that day.
Mine wasn't.
Yours was from...
I did that previously in Hove.
Yes.
Whereas this one I was asked to read in advance, so I had a bit of practice.
You had a bit more practice.
Yeah.
Well, you need practice, because it was... I have to say, the pieces read that day, some of them I thought were okay. But there were two pieces that really, really impressed me. Eric read something that he'd written the day before, which I was absolutely blown away by.
Yes.
About going with his father to pick coal off basically a slag heap to keep warm as a child. And it was a very moving story and beautifully written. And he'd written it in a space of about less than an hour the day before.
That was extraordinary.
I don't know how he'd done that. I mean, he's a very good writer, but he'd done such a good job. Yeah. And then you came on to read from a passage from your novel, which... it was an extraordinary story about a young man's first venture onto what is commonly known as a meat rack, basically an area where young guys will go and sell themselves for sex. And it was moving, yes. It was beautifully descriptive, but it was also very, very funny. Now, a lot of the humour came from your writing, but the biggest part of the humour came from the fact that, like all good, diverse events, there was a signer, and
I couldn't look at.
Fortunately, she was behind you, but we can talk about this on the programme. This young guy who's having his first experience as rent, and it's not a comfortable experience.
No.
He's deeply disturbed by it. He sort of knows he has to be there. It's a rite of passage that he has to go through, but he doesn't have a good experience. And eventually he gets picked up by a man who drags him off into a tunnel by a canal in Birmingham and basically has to perform oral sex. Now, the vision of this lady signing an oral sex scene has to be one of the moments of great comedy of all time, because your description in your writing was quite lyrical, but also quite explicit. And you could see her doing it. Did she have a chance to rehearse this? Because it can't be common parlance for the signer.
No, she told me afterwards that she mimed it.
She certainly did.
It was mime rather than...
the key moments were the description of the rather abrasive and rough pubic hair.
Yeah, that's
which
the bit
I had miming for that was quite extraordinary. I think it would have doubled for Brillo pad or any form of pan scrubber, as other pan scrubbers are available. But anyways, were you aware of the fact that we in the audience were crying, laughing, as you read?
No.
Because, I've read at Polari as well, and the piece I read was about a scene on a beach where three guys end up having, a spit roast. And their friends return, and through the heat haze on the sands. It's like, and reading that in a library in North London to a very small gathering of ladies was one of those moments in my life that I thought, swallow me up now. Because you could see on their faces that they were changing. Mm. But did you blank us out? Did you manage to sort of separate yourself?
A bit. It was such a big audience, actually. And I was surprised, because Polari is usually an evening event.
Yes.
And
it was a good turnout.
Yeah, they had to keep bringing in more chairs and stuff. And my eyesight's really bad, so it's kind of quite easy to blur. I can see close up, but I can't see distance, and I didn't wear glasses because then I wouldn't have been able to read.
With you. What's the novel called?
At the moment, it's been through about 20 changes, but at the moment it's called Love and Destruction. And it's essentially a love story set over three decades against the AIDS crisis and the aftermath.
And how much of it have you sourced from your own experience?
It's not autobiographical. Some of the characters are amalgamations of people I've known. All of the places, I've tended to use the places I was during those times. So it's set in Wales originally and then Birmingham in the 80s. Then London in the 90s. I think London in the 80s and 90s was very, very different to the rest of the country. You know, I could probably put the Wales and Birmingham together and make one place. But it's nice having the descriptive thing. And also Wales was, you know, after the miners' strike, it was a very depressed, grey place. And the thing about moving to Birmingham was suddenly there were all these... a very multicultural place, and it was very, very colourful in terms of, you know, Spark Hill, the shops with all the amazing fruit and veg and the sari silks and everything.
And as a young gay man, was it accepting? Was it an easy place to live as a gay man then?
Yeah, and actually it was... and we were living in a Muslim area, and... because I clearly wasn't a Muslim, I wasn't expected to conform. So I actually found it extremely welcoming, and you know, we were left to get on with it, really. And also, it was that point. It was kind of Spark Hill, Moseley, and Moseley's quite a place where everybody does things. And in the 80s, I think it was also. Nobody had jobs. Mm. You know, we were all signing on, so everybody was in a band or a designer or a writer or doing something, and it was kind of like, it was a very, very creative place, but, yeah, nobody was really getting paid, but there was always lots going on.
How do you fit writing into your daily routine? Do you set aside a particular point in the day where you write?
I try and spend a few hours. Originally, with the first draft, I did 1,000 words a day. And initially it was very, very compulsive. It was a strange thing, the way the story came about, because I had the idea of this love story for years and years and years that was originally just set in the 80s against activism and the miners' strike and youth CND and all those things. And 2 years ago, there was that period where everybody started dying. You know, lots of famous people.
Yes.
And but also a few people in my family. And then my nephew, Christian, was the lead singer of Viola Beach, the band that died together in a car crash in Sweden. And my first reaction was, it's happening again. And I thought, hold on, what? That's not a logical reaction. So I started thinking about it and realised it was that trauma of having people dying around you all the time. And I started looking at lots of other things, and things like Paul O'Grady's autobiography, for instance. And I think he said that nobody who lived through that came out unscarred. And I just saw symbols of it everywhere. So
when might we be able to read this book?
I'm on the second draft.
And you have a publisher?
I don't have a publisher yet. I was shortlisted for Myriad first draft.
So there's a good chance. And of course, these days, you can self-publish very successfully and do it online and make all the money yourself.
I'm sort of... It's interesting because the publishing world, I think, is in flux at the moment. It's a very...
It's very
it's
changed.
Open to disruption, I think.
Sadly, we've run out of time, Tony. I know everyone who's watching will want to read the book, and particularly this scene under the Canal Bridge arch. Thank you for joining me today.
Other sex scenes are available.
Other sex scenes are available. Thank you for watching, Queer Say. Thank you for joining me today. Soufflé, not Queer Say. We'll see you all very soon.
Thank
Good
you.
Night.
Thank you very much, Andrew.